is. I wanted to say a few words about what bodhicitta is, which is impossible, but also possible. To just start getting a smell of bodhicitta. I don't know about you, but when I first encountered this idea of bodhicitta, wow! It's beyond my imagination capacity. It's impossible. You know, I felt that way as a teenager when I encountered Dharma, because bodhicitta is the main pillar of the Mahayana Bahiko, Great Bahiko, which encompasses all beings, this vast aspirations. But as I grew older and started to have maybe not that far, you know, something we can develop, we can cultivate, we can unveil on a day-to-day basis. It's not like, are we waiting until reaching certain point, then finally we dive into bodhicitta. No, just right here. There's not too late. Whatever stages you are at in this human journey, it's not too late. Just right here, maybe from today on, your life become bodhicitta. You live bodhicitta. I want to talk briefly about that. Next one is, what's special about bodhicitta? What's the benefit? That's very important to cultivate. Shantideva, many of you know the text called A Guide to Bodhisattva Way of Life, very classic text in the Buddhist tradition, talks about excellence of bodhicitta, chapter 1. So I thought today I try to do my best to follow what Shantideva talks about. What's good about advantages and benefit of bodhicitta? Because we learn more about benefit, then we feel like we want to do something, right? We want to get it. So that's very important. So that's the kind of first step. Maybe what bodhicitta is, and then benefit of bodhicitta, which include the metaphor of bodhicitta. We want to say how classical text talks about using the metaphor or the example. Finally, I want to bring down to our own experience how to practice bodhicitta in our daily life, day-to-day life. Perhaps moment to moment, in any occasions. Not only when we are comfortable, when we are sick, when we are dying at the time of death. And also, this will be carried out in the future, Bardo. Do you have that sort of belief system, transition? In any occasion, then end with sharing a little bit and reflection and dedication. That's my plan. What is bodhicitta? We already started to have a smell of bodhicitta, not when we are meditating. Did you have some sense of it? In fact, like a glimmer of bodhicitta, glimmer of this love and compassion brought you here. I have 100% trust. If you haven't had that, you wouldn't have been here. This kind of subject, spending whole hour for this kind of topic. Love and compassion is the basis of bodhicitta. Then I also talked about, during the meditation, definition of love and compassion in the Buddhist context. But don't need to worry about too much those things. You already have innate. This caring feeling, but we need to expand that, because sometimes we just love for very vague, love for all sentient beings. I work for the happiness of all sentient beings, or I care about my family, and I have a strong love for my beloved, but not that much for people in a certain country or, you know, certain people. See, so this bodhicitta idea is all sentient beings, then including yourself. I often translate as complete openness of our heart. So this is a skill we can develop, and not something just naturally happens magically, like we become like Dalai Lama, you know, we wish. No, he made an effort. He is making effort day to day. Then became like that sort of person whom everybody loves. So we want to, you know, we need to know how to go about it and how to think about. Maybe this can be the beginning of the melting iceberg. Yeah, just starting this process. So never too late. And also this premise of all happiness coming from caring others, and all suffering comes from caring self. Caring self. In the West, we say that self-cherishing. Then people might say that what's wrong with self-cherishing? We should cherish ourselves because we have such a low self-esteem, so something like that. But we are talking about self-centeredness, no? Do you know what I'm talking about? Am I the only one? I know this one. You know, so this one is an enemy. We really have to identify that. For that, we need a shift in perspective, shift in way of looking at things. Because we have been living in a reversed psychology or reversed way of doing things. So this kind of Buddhist wisdom or the great master's wisdom, insight, brings us to really the reality, accord with the reality, and it works. Dalai Lama often talks about if you want to selfish, wisely selfish. So what's that means? It's important to kind of dive into that aspect as well. When we say the bodhicitta, there are many ways to translate, but the bodhi means awakening, citta is mind, or the mind and the heart. In Buddhism, you know, mind and heart. Yeah, there are many words related to the mind, but this is I feel both mind and heart. This intense desire to alleviate suffering of all beings. Bodhicitta is a basic human or innate human, you can say wisdom. Or human goodness that can drive away the sorrow of the world. There are many ways to classify it, but there are two levels, relative and ultimate. Many of you may know, in the relative level, bodhicitta expresses itself for longing or aspiration. It is a heartfelt yearning to free oneself and others from the pain of ignorance, habitual patterns, clinging, all these conflicted emotions. First, free oneself in order to help others to the same. So that's a relative one. That one you can relate a little bit, and the smell of what you brought you here, this compassion and the love. Then that leads to this relative bodhicitta, if you cultivate. Then the desire to end the suffering of all being. Don't you think we all have that? You know, every day we open up the news, looking at the news. You know, I wish this would end. Next day, tomorrow will be better than open up the news. It got worse or a different problem. But then each of us has this kind of innate desire to eliminate the suffering of all beings. Of course, those beings we never met or never will meet, as well as those we hate or we disagree. That's the bodhicitta. So it's a complete boundless openness of our heart. It goes to the not only your family or yourself, it's expand. That's the relative level. Then absolute level, bodhicitta is, you can say, non-dual wisdom, wisdom of emptiness, wisdom of reality, the vast, unbiased essence of mind. No me, self, and others. What's the difference? Just take a moment to think about what differentiates you from others. This skin of your body, very arbitrary differentiation we are making. Then, if your family, your child there, belong to you, not others, and whatever. Anyway, so this bodhicitta mind is beyond that unbiased essence of mind, because this understanding of wisdom of emptiness, which is quite profound. So maybe I cannot say just one word, but just to say the reality is the beyond this dualistic idea. But you started to have this connection, no? When you were breathing. Just imagine this air is shared by all being, all creatures, you and me. You are depending on others. Kindness of others, actually. Well, we are product of kindness of all beings. We wouldn't have been here if there was no kindness given to us, this gratitude and appreciation. It doesn't make sense how we live our life right now, as if we are living ourselves. I'm independent. So that sort of interconnectedness, interrelatedness, that brings us some sense of there's no solid me here and other there kind of idea. And that's called embarrassingly simplistic explanation, but the explanation of emptiness. That's proved the emptiness. There's no such object or reality out there or in here. Like a dream, a person in a dream. When you wake up from the dream, no matter how much you suffer or think about that person during the dream, when you wake up, it disappears. It's gone. Everything is like that. But anyway, so that wisdom aspect is the absolute bodhicitta. So bodhicitta consists of those two, you can say, levels, two dimensions, relative bodhicitta and absolute bodhicitta. So then I wanted to jump into the advantages of bodhicitta, what's good about bodhicitta. For this, I wanted to use chapter 1 of Shantideva's text. So not this is something I made up. I often made up something, but you might not trust me. So I just want to use the Shantideva, what Shantideva talks about. The way that the practice of altruism benefit one's life, everyday life, oneself and others. So it's not only benefiting ourselves, benefiting others, benefiting all beings. Because it's such an important subject. What's good about bodhicitta, especially long-term practitioners, take it for granted. You know, supposed to have bodhicitta. We take a refuge and generate bodhicitta every morning and evening and whatever. Kind of stagnated, so to speak. Then we really need to know what's good about bodhicitta. That really inspired us to grow more and more. You know, when we dedicate, it said, may bodhicitta, precious and sublime, arise where it has not arisen. Our initial longing to care for others, so this one, it hasn't arisen. We want the bodhicitta to arisen. Then where it has arisen or arose, where already bodhicitta, like a spark of bodhicitta generated, those of you who have taken, formally taken the bodhisattva vows and generate the bodhicitta, then we need to cultivate, keep it growing more and more. Then it said grow and flourish, ever more and more. So that sort of practice, very important. We not just settled into, okay, I receive, or today, for example, we talk about the bodhicitta and go over the benefit, then end. No, this is meant for putting into our own practice, day-to-day basis. Then we change our mind. We change. It's so difficult to change this habitual pattern, but it's possible. Luckily or fortunately, we can see the example who did that, such as His Holiness Dalai Lama, can exchange self for others, me and others. You know, in English phrase, like putting oneself for others' shoes, you know, so that's become our life, way of life, called Bodhisattva way of life. Yeah, that's the title of this text. Then you can say, and now, as long as space endures, as long as there are being to be found, may I continue likewise to remain, to drive away the sorrow of the world. So you can say like that. Just started to have a smell of bodhicitta. That's enough to begin with. Because we are not innately evil or innately damaged. We are bodhicitta. We are basic goodness, Buddha nature. So then trust start building more and more. As if we cannot do anything about what's going on in the world. Sometimes we discourage. But this is the best medicine to really remove that discouragement want to become courageous. I want to go over one by one. Just we are entering into this vast subject, but I'm very passionate about it. So lots to talk about. I'm going to list the 10 benefits, although it might be difficult to do that among immeasurable benefits or advantages bodhicitta has. First one is we please the Buddha. We make awakened one happy. What's good about that, right? I want to make my partner happy, but what's the importance of making Buddha happy? But that's the first benefit. Why Buddha became a Buddha? Yeah, Buddha's entire focus is on benefiting sentient being, right? That's only solo purpose. So when we cherish others and cultivate bodhicitta and act on it, not only thinking about, act on it, then we are helping to fulfill Buddha's aim. We are helping Buddha's because his solo purpose is helping others. Then we become, you can say, the Buddha's heir or Buddha's children. We are part of Buddha's clan or the tribe, Buddha tribe. So that's number one. Then number two, bodhicitta is our real friend. Do you agree? Our real friend who that never leaves us, never deserts us, never abandon us, never disappoint us. You know, we have lots of friends, right? And also partners and family members. No matter how much we love them, sometimes they disappoint us or desert us. Sooner or later, desert us. Either we go or they go. Meeting and parting. That's the condition. But this bodhicitta is our real friend who never abandoned us. We can count on it, on him or her. Bodhicitta is reliable and will always be present in our heart. Once we generate and keep cultivating, always available, no matter where it is, even in the middle of war, in the middle of desert, middle of something, nowhere. You don't need the equipment. You don't need the physical form. You keep here in our heart, always. It's very portable, you can say. Portable and the best friend. Always assist us. Best friend that never judges us. Sometimes friends and other people around us judge us, but never judges us and always encourages us. No encouragement. I'm sure you have that experience, something you, oh my gosh, I can't do this. Then just remember the spark of bodhicitta at your heart. Then kind of, okay, kind of gives us energy, no? Like encourage us to do something virtuous, even no matter how difficult it may be, no matter how painful, you know, remembering all this past or whatever. So anyway, always encourage us to do what is virtuous, that's bodhicitta, best friend. And also keep us on a journey, prevent us from astray. Always bring it back to the core meaning, core purpose of our human journey, spiritual journey, if you own that. That's a best friend, no? Friend always bring us to the right track, so to speak. So that's number two. So I want you to contemplate perhaps a little bit when we finish this section. Number three is, what do you think? Our lives become very purposeful, meaningful. You know, sometimes you say, my life does not have a purpose, or something like that. I have to find the purpose of my life. And I try to do that. No. But if you have this, our lives become very meaningful. Everything, whatever we do in our lives, we feel that we can do something to benefit others. And also the situation in the world doesn't overwhelm us anymore if we have this. You know, sometimes we feel, looking at the news and some, overwhelmed, and our heart breaks. Yes, bodhisattva, the heart is completely open and raw. That's why it breaks. But then also have a courage and also this purpose. So doesn't overwhelmed, keep going, develop the ability to cope with it, doesn't kind of give up on it. So that's very important comfort. Don't you think it's good to have a bodhicitta? You started to have an enthusiastic little bit about this, knowing benefit. So our life becomes very purposeful, meaningful. A sense of meaning, sense of purpose in our lives. Something that drives and direct our energy in a good direction. That's what we want to know. So much things seems going on, then so easily to be pulled, then strayed. And then coming back, that's okay. But sometimes once we pull, then again become a habitual patterns and then completely stray from the purpose. Why I'm here? What's the purpose, meaning of my life? So that's number three. So number four is that this is the best way to serve others. Sometimes people ask, how can I help? How can I serve? You know, there are lots of sublime activities in the world, you know, feeding and sending money, and all those things are sublime, holy, holy activities. But this is the best way to serve others through altruism, love, and compassion. If we wish to help our family members or our partners, then this is it. This is the best way to help. Help through this altruism. Number five, we become balanced and relate to people in a direct and straightforward way. So as a human being, you know, human citizen, we want to be really balanced and not so much have a prejudice or judgment and projection or all those things. His Holiness said, my religion is a kindness. So we want to be a kind person, kind toward every being without discrimination. So if we have bodhicitta, we become like that. So if we don't have altruism and trying to be people pleasers, do you know that one? People pleaser to win others' approval. Often we do that. Now, without really deep sense of love and compassion and this sense of service toward others, then our actions will be based on wanting or looking for something in return. If we don't get something returned, then we get disappointed or we get frustrated or something like that. So that's not the bodhicitta. Bodhisattva does not expect anything in return. Just to do. That's the way of saying that His Holiness is saying, you know, if you want to selfish, then wisely selfish. Then number six, we will not feel alienated or discouraged. Do you agree? If you have a bodhicitta in your heart, never, never alone. In solitude, least alone, that's the Christian mystic's word. If you have a bodhicitta, if you have a caring for all beings, always in your heart, never be isolated. So you can say, instead of taking antidepressant, keep this bodhicitta. Learn how to cultivate, learn how to connect to bodhicitta. Then all this loneliness and what you call the modern disease, your kind of isolation or something, will go. We get depressed when we are overwhelmed by situations and feel helpless. But if we have this of altruism, then we realize there's a lot we can do. And we feel encouraged and uplifted. We are joyful because we know we are going to be in the right direction. Oh my gosh, today we want to practice. I wanted to share the Tonren, beautiful Tonren practice from Ear Whisper lineage. So that you can bring that to your daily life. Because that's the important part too, how we can cultivate love and compassion, which can bring to this bodhicitta. Then I wanted to do the Tonren practice, maybe three times we recite. Then if you're completely new to Tonren, don't worry about it. giving and taking. So you just using a breath, just who you are, already you have this innate goodness here, love and compassion. So then connect to the suffering, or just get in touch with the misery which we share. But then all the beings around you and wherever. If you like, you can specifically focus on the group of people, or those people who in the war zone, enemies, stranger, friends, whatever way. Then that's breathing, right? So taking the suffering onto yourself, and then breathe out, then send out whatever goodness you own. Give it away. Especially something you attach to. What do you attach? Partner? Then send out to those beings who feel lonely, need a partner. Send it out. Something attach. Or memories. Memory from the past. Just send out. Then transform the beautiful offering. Whatever they need. Okay, that, those of you who are familiar with Tonden, whatever form, there are many ways to practice Tonden. So whatever form you can practice, you do that. These four stages. First, we request a blessing for the awake presence, which is in the form of a teacher. Please, teacher, bless me so that my heart is completely burst open. And this bring compassion and love to the higher state, growing more and more, so that my bodhicitta grows more and more. So something like that, right? Then in the end, the fourth stage is really imagine that actually happens, okay? So all beings are kind of settled in a great bliss or happiness and joy. Just take a moment to feel into your body again and imagine all beings surrounding you, perhaps facing you, counting on you. Then with this courageous heart, start to act on it. Then above the sky, or the front of you, the awake presence, Buddha's smiling face of Buddha's. They are so happy you are about to embark on this virtuous journey. So we ask them for blessing, rain of blessing. When you are doing this one, perhaps you can also imagine all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and all the great masters of the past and throwing the beautiful lotus petals or something like that, or rain of blessing. So that helps us to moisture our heart. Tenajetsum Lamatuje Chemahogyudove Dededungekum Marutanda Dharamimba Tanda Kidege Shenrata Vahai Dokum de tam denbaru chinki rodokum de tam denbaru chinki. Now, my holy master, compassionate one, bless me. Oh, my mother beings, may all your suffering, negative act, and obscurations ripen upon me right now. May all my happiness, and the goodness go to others, go to you. And so may all beings have bliss and joy, happiness. Tena jetsum namahatu je chema kyudo e de de dunge kum maru tanda dharamimba tanda hakidege shenata vahai dokum detam nembaru chinki rodo kundetam nembaru chinki. Just take a moment to rest in the echo of today's practice. See if you can rest in this non-duality, self and others, as if you are resting as a vast sky, boundless, no separation between self and others. You just established all beings and bliss, happiness, and joy. See if you can rest in the confidence of this actuality of this, or possibility, powerful possibility of actually this happens. So I wanted to end with again Bodhicitta dedication. May Bodhicitta, precious and sublime, arise where it has not arisen. And where it has arisen, may it not decline. Grow and flourish ever more and more. And now, as long as space endures, and as long as there are beings to be found, may I continue likewise to remain, to drive away the sorrows of the world.